Iubiți frați și surori, domnilor și domnilor, vă invit respectos să rămânem ridicați în picioare și cei care aveți Sfânta Carte a dumneavoastră, să o deschideți la Epistola lui Pavel către Romani, unde în limba română voi citi primele două versete. Aceasta va fi aproape singura parte care va fi rostită în limba română, iar apoi în limba engleză permiteți-mi să citesc începând cu versetul 1 până la 7 inclusiv. For those of you who have your Bibles handy, I ask you to open along with me to Romans chapter 1. I'll be reading in Romanian the first two verses. Thereafter, I'll be reading in English from verse 1 through 7. Să ascultăm cu bucurie acest cuvânt atât de frumos și atât de relevant pentru noi în anul 2013 la Phoenix, Arizona, și pretutindeni în întreaga lume. Cuvântul lui Dumnezeu spune în felul următor: Pavel, rob al lui Iisus Hristos, chemat să fie apostol, pus deoparte să vestească Evanghelia lui Dumnezeu, pe care o făgăduise mai înainte prin prorocii săi în Sfintele Scripturi. Romans chapter 1 verse 1 says as follows: Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith amongst all the nations for his name, among whom you also are called of Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, to all who are in Happy Valley, to all who are in every city under God's and in God's green earth, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Iubiților, este o bucurie deosebită să fim din nou împreună la această ocazie binecuvântată. Mulțumim Domnului pentru această ocazie. Totodată mulțumim bisericii locale, fratelui Cornel Avram, păstorul coordonator, împreună cu întreg bordul pastoral din Arizona, împreună cu toți tinerii, frații mai în vârstă, care au postit, care s-au rugat, împreună cu fanfara, corurile și cei care și-au pus timp deoparte să vină să ne închinăm înainte lui Dumnezeu. Știu că Dumnezeu va răsplăti orice lucrare făcută pentru gloria Lui și slăvit să fie Domnul. Organizația, organizarea și toate care au fost făcute până aici au fost sub binecuvântarea lui Dumnezeu, care este un Dumnezeu care face toate lucrurile frumoase în timpul Lui. Binecuvântat să fie Dumnezeu! Iubiților, primiți salutări sfinte din partea Bisericii din Seattle, Washington, de la pastorul nostru, Vasile Antemie, care a avut un cuvânt, un mesaj scurt aseară, împreună cu fratele Vali Nuțu și eu, fratele Corneliu Mihăilă, frate Ionel Tătăran, suntem aici și cu ceilalți din Seattle. Haideți să vedem cât sunt din Seattle în biserica, din biserica în adunare locală, să ridicem picioare. All the Seattleites. Yes. Dumnezeu să binecuvinteze Seattle. Este adevărat, ploile au început la noi și am venit să ne uscăm câte un pic, dar am văzut că ploaia ne-a urmat aici. Dar slăvit să fie Domnul pentru toate lucrurile. Amin. Iubiților, mesajul care îl voi avea în limba engleză este un mesaj care este aproape, foarte aproape de inima mea. The message that I would like to have and would like to meditate on along with you tonight is a message that's very dear to my heart. Initially, when I was given the text of Romans chapter 1, verse 1, I was looking for something that the Lord would have to speak to me personally. And I found it. And the minute I found it, I knew it was something that God didn't just speak to me, but it's my prayer, it's my earnest prayer that he would speak it to you. Verse 1 starts and says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ. Paul. Paul, a man that was born with a good status. This guy was a Jew. He was the Jew from the tribe of Benjamin. Now, Benjamin, besides those in Judah, were the ones that at least half the tribe followed David. They had a special place in the heart of the Jewish people. Paul was born with certain good birthrights. He was a Jew of Jews. Now, Paul grew up, and he grew up in a good family. He grew up and he went to the Harvard of America, the Oxford of Europe. This guy was an Ivy League school graduate. And he wasn't just a cum laude like some of us. This guy was a summa cum laude. This guy graduated top of his class. If there was a 4.0, he got a 4.2. That was Paul. Paul was a likely candidate to be part of the Jewish people and sit in the top 70 seats in all of Israel, part of the Sanhedrin, part of the big boys club. This guy was no minor leaguer. This guy had a clear direction. He had his life planned out for him. He studied hard and he worked hard. He got good grades and he showed it. Now, this guy wasn't someone who we would term as lazy and not diligent. He was hardworking. He was upwardly mobile. I mean, he was well-educated. He was from a good family. He had the genes to be everything that society could offer him. And on top of that, he was also something that many Jews were not. He was a Roman citizen. In other words, the Romans couldn't mess with him. If they could mess with the other Jews and say, listen, these guys are just the scum or the on the outskirts of society, they couldn't say that about Paul because he would pull out his certificate of citizenship and said, listen, I've got citizenship in Rome. You can't treat me like the rest. Now, I don't want to go into the details of historical theology and history of the first century. But Paul, in all likelihood, could have been the Josephus, the historian of the Jewish race and of the Jewish people. But instead, something happened to Paul. While he was on his road and he thought that he had everything figured out, he'd done the right school, he was from the right family, he had the right background. He knew the right languages. He knew the right culture. He'd studied philosophy. He'd studied theology. He'd studied everything. He thought that he had all of the answers to life's fundamental questions. And then one day, Paul, who thought he had it all figured out, realized that there was a missing link to his life. Realized that something wasn't as rosy as it seemed. Realized that he needed to do something and something needed to be done to him if he truly wanted to have a fruitful life. Now we're gathered here today and the general theme of this convention is rediscovering your passion for service. Rediscovering your passion for life. And as I look at myself and as I look at all of us here, many times in life, we go through ups and downs. Sometimes we're on a high mountain. Many times we're in a death valley. And we're going lower and lower. Many times people that you would think have it all figured out, they look good, they get good grades, they've got money, they've got it all. They have something that's missing in their life. They're just not happy. They're just not with it. When you look at their private life, it's just not going the way it should. Well, that's kind of what was happening to Paul. And one day I realized
that that's what was happening to me. You see, Paul didn't really have it all figured out, like I didn't really have it all figured out. And maybe like you that are sitting here today don't have it all figured out. You've got your anxieties. You're wondering if you're good enough. You're wondering if you're popular enough. You're wondering if people like you. You're wondering if God likes you. You're wondering if there's another chance for you, whether you're physically present here or whether you're watching on the internet. These are all fundamental questions. Maybe you're a minister who's ready to throw in the towel and saying, listen, I've been serving for 10, 20, 30 years, and it's getting kind of old. There's no more passion. I speak and nobody listens. Not even those in my house listen. Well, you know, Paul had the same issues that were going on in his life. He was wondering whether it's worth it all. He was wondering, listen, should I keep going on when there's something vitally missing in his life? And then that vital something happened to him. That link that was missing came into his life, and it made sense of absolutely everything. And that's why tonight, looking at the scripture, I would like us all to look at the fundamental issues that we have in life, and I'd like us to look at the key to understanding life on earth. The key to understanding human life on earth, because dear friends, if you don't have this figured out, nothing will work. If you don't have this figured out, even though you've got a good degree, even though you've got a job or you don't have a job, it's not going to make sense. Even though you may think you have a good family, even though you may think you have a good name, without this, it just doesn't work. With this, whether you're married or single, with this, whether you're rich or poor, with this key, with this fundamental link to life that makes sense of absolutely everything, it doesn't matter who likes you. It doesn't matter how popular you are. It doesn't matter how old you are. All that really matters is that you understand this fundamental principle in life. And you know what this fundamental principle of life is? Paul talks about it and he introduces it in chapter 1, verse 1 of Romans. What does he say? He says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to what? To something called the gospel of God. Tonight, I'd like us all to meditate on what this fundamental phrase means, the gospel of God, and use this as the key, the fundamental key to understanding all of life. So let's begin. What does it mean according to Paul, according to the Holy Scriptures? What does the gospel of God mean as far as the key to understanding life? The gospel of God starts out and it says that if we're going to understand life, we have to understand that we are created persons. If we want to understand what we are made about and what we are in our life and in our being and in our essence, we have to understand that we were created. Now, Paul expands in Romans chapter 1, verse 2, where he says that he incorporates the entire Old Testament scriptures in what he's talking about when he says, separated to the gospel of God, which he, God, promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Beforehand, when Paul was this wonderful elite Ivy League graduate Jew, he thought, and in his mind, he had two tiers of society. There was a top tier, and there was a bottom tier. The top tier were all of the Jews. The top tier were the elite, the people of God. And then there was the bottom tier, which was absolutely everyone else. They were considered the goyim, the dogs. Yeah, humans, but not really. Not someone who you'd want to hang out with, not someone who you want to sit at the table with, not someone who you want to have fellowship with. And then something happened. Paul, even though in his heart of hearts knew that everyone was created by God, began to understand life differently.
And how did he understand life differently? Well, he threw out the two-tiered system and he got back to Genesis. And you know, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, I can remember years ago in Los Angeles, California, at the convention in 1990, I think it was. 89? This man there was preaching. I remember your sermon. Not all of it. Brother Lescaut, I was just a young lad, a student. Not of an Ivy League school, but a student.
And I remember Brother Peter saying that God created the entire world, everything that came into existence, with the words of his mouth. Do you remember saying that?
Yeah.
And then he said, and I remember thinking in my mind that, yes, that's wonderful. God formed Adam. He didn't speak Adam into existence. God took some dust, some dirt, and he formed Adam. And he breathed into Adam the breath of life, and man became a living being. And I thought that was just fantastic. But you know, I never realized. I thought that each and every one of us, even though God created the first human, Adam, and then Eve, from the rib of Adam, molded, and God's hands personally touched Adam and Eve, I thought that the rest of us were created by God, because the Bible says that God created us. I thought we were created by God in a distant fashion. In other words, God went up to heaven, and he didn't come back down and take his hands and mold us and make us. And part of popular Christian thought is that, you know, God just works remotely. Well, when it comes to the creation that includes me and includes everyone here, God will not have it that way. When God created and formed man with his hands, he didn't stop with Adam and Eve. He formed each and every one of us with his hands. Now, for some of you, that may seem strange. But for those of you that seem strange, and for those of you who can put the verses on the board, on the overhead, take a look at Job chapter 10, verse 8. See, Job is in a crisis. Job doesn't understand why God is making him suffer. And in the midst of his crisis, Job reveals his theology. Yes, it's a historical book. Yes, it has poetic parts to it, but it's part of the inspired works of God, and all of Job's words are validated by God. When in the end of the book of Job, God tells his three friends, and he's a little bit upset with them, for they have not spoken rightly of God as my servant Job has. So let's take a look at what Job says about God. Verse 8 says, "Your hands have made me and fashioned me an intricate unity." You see, to make sense of life, to make sense of ministry, to make sense of this world in which we live, we cannot make sense of it unless we all recognize and realize and admit and have it ingrained into our minds and re-ingrained into our minds that we didn't just happen to come upon this earth. Now, most of us don't think that we just came upon this earth. Most of us think that our mom and dad kind of had something to do with it, and they did. But you know something? Mom and dad didn't create us. God created us. Amen. Mom and dad, yes, willed us to come into existence and participated and willed in the plan of God, and God gave them that grace. But once things started happening, you know whose hands started forming Leonard in the womb in 1966?
It was the hand of God. Yes. Praise God for that. Take a look. "Your hands have made me and fashioned me in intricate unity." Job says, "Yet
Would you destroy me? Remember, I pray, that you have made me like clay. And will you turn me into dust again? Did you not pour me out like milk and curdle me like cheese? Clothe me with skin and flesh and knit me together with bones and sinews. You've granted me life and favor, and your care has preserved my spirit. Now, you all know Psalm 139. Read that if you need further confirmation from the poetic literature. We've got the law in Genesis. We've got a historical and poetic book. We've got the Psalms as poetry. We have the minor and the major prophets. Let me read from one of the major prophets in Isaiah that says the following. Isaiah 64, verses 8, and Isaiah 44, 24. I'll read 64, verse 8. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are potter. And all we are the work of what? Of your hand. Now, when Paul, the Jew who thought he had it all worked out, recognizes that it's God's hand who made him, it's God's hand who didn't just make him, he made absolutely everybody else. Listen, he never forgot this. This was an essential part of the gospel of God and needs to be an essential part in every gospel message. Because you know something? The gospel of God does not start with sin. No, there's something before sin. You know what comes before sin? It's creation. We're created in God's image. And God cares about those whom he creates. Romans chapter 10, verse 12 says, there's no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is over all and rich to all who call upon him. Look at that inclusive language. This is not a Jew who thinks of a two-tiered system. This is a Jew who thinks that all are created according to God's image. He doesn't let us forget it. Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11. I'll read Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Now, why does this matter? Why is this so fundamental to understanding life? You know why? Because the devil knows it's fundamental to understanding life. And he has tried hard in the past 300 to 400 years to take creation out of society and tell us all that we weren't created beings. You know, we've all bought into the environment, haven't we? You know, the environment, that's not even English. When the people decided on using a term to describe the world, God's green earth, people said, well, listen, what do we call everything that's around us to make it sound good? And they couldn't come up with a term. And the only term that kind of made sense was creation. But you know what they said? They said, wait a minute, if we say creation, then that automatically presupposes a creator. Forget it. Let's use environment. And as such, environment is kind of this. This is an environment. It's not global. It's not cosmic. The word doesn't fit, but that doesn't matter. So how about when all of us start referring to the environment, we start referring to creation. And in creation, it includes me. You see, because when God created this all, we have to recognize that we didn't just appear by chance. You, dear friend, are here on this earth. You are alive in this generation because God wanted you to be alive in this generation. Amen. You appeared in your family because God wanted you to appear in the family in which you were in, not another family. You were born Romanian because God wanted you to be born Romanian. Had he wanted you to be a Mexican, an African, he would have made you a Mexican and an African. But he made you a Romanian who lives in America. And that's by design. If you're 50 and bald, that's by design. If you're 5'2", that's by design. If you're 6'8", that's by design. God scripted And he said, you shall be 6'2", and you shall look like this. Why? Because I, God, have a plan with you, and my hands made you, and God doesn't make accidents, dear friends. So maybe we should behave differently with God's creation, don't you think? You know, if I've just waxed my car, it's been a while, but if I wax my car, and my kids get in there and they get it dirty, I says, hey, daddy just cleaned the car, for crying out loud. You want to clean it next time? We take care of our things. Well, you know, God formed each and every one of us. That's important. That means that we have intricate value. That means that we have dignity. That's why we have to take care of the elderly. That's why we can't have abortions. Because God's hand started to work inside the womb. Do you see how this has to do with life? Do you see how if it's God's will that someone who's 85 and has cancer dies, it's God's will, he created him or her. Leonard didn't create, Leonard doesn't decide. It's God who created. And as such, we've got to get that fundamental thing down in our minds and in our heads. The youth has to get it down. The elderly has to get it down. And what does this do for us ministers? You know, it's God's children that we're called to love, to grow, to be patient with, to tenderly take to green pastures. And it's God who designed us for this very purpose. Yeah, maybe 10 or 20 other people could have done it, but they didn't. God called you and God called me to do this. Let's step up to the plate and do a better job. Let's give it more passion. Let's give it more seriousness. Let's give it more compassion. Let's work to really do it right for God. You know, Paul in Acts chapter 17, verse 28 and 29, quotes a pagan philosopher when he says, for your pagan philosopher says, for we are also his offspring. Let us not forget that God is still in the business of creating, not a machine assembly made job. Everything that God does is handmade. And you know, there are millions of women who are currently pregnant. You know, I just watched my wife go through 9 months of pregnancy. And about a month ago, I saw a beautiful little baby boy.
Congratulations. Congratulations. Hallelujah.
You know, he looks like my dad. He's got the Semenya frown. His name is Samuel Leonard. But he's God's creation. God's hands formed him in the womb, programmed his DNA, his protein, everything. You see, would you just take a few seconds and look to those to the right and to the left? And say, you're a wonderful creation of God.
Wonderful creation of God.
Young people, those of you who are going to university, those of you who are being indoctrinated with evolution, those of you who are being indoctrinated with secular humanism, please remember that at the convention in Arizona, the Word of God spoke to you. And part, a vital part of understanding what this life, what this human life is all about, a vital part of the gospel of God is recognizing, admitting, and internalizing that we are created persons by none other and God himself, praise be to God, amen. The next thing we have to recognize when we talk about understanding the fundamental principles of life is that we must understand that we're not just created beings. And you got to watch out here. I don't want to sound harsh, but I don't think this is talked about, and if it is, it's not realized, it's not internalized as much as it needs to be. We must understand that we are fallen persons. Suntem persoane căzute. Nu doar persoane create, suntem persoane căzute. We are fallen persons. Paul, in Romans chapter 1, in verse 18 to 32, explains the reality of Gentile fallenness. Now, this is just great. You think, well, wait a minute, Paul's back up to his old tricks. He's bashing on the Gentiles. Paul, were you born again? Well, no, he just says, listen, the Gentiles, by nature, do the things that their nature kind of teaches them to do. Why? Because they're fallen creatures. And then something absolutely incredible happens in Romans chapter 2. As soon as the Romans, now the church in Rome, and let me just make a short parenthesis, the church in Rome, generally speaking, is believed to have been part of, composed initially, largely of Jews. And then an edict came by the Caesar at that time that all the Jews were to leave Rome. But the church is Christ, so the church goes on. But you know something, if the senior pastor then was a Jew and he had to get out of town, guess who became senior pastor? One of the Gentiles. And as a matter of fact, the face of the church started to change, and they looked more like a Gentile church. And then something strange happened. The edict was gone, and the Jews came back. And now the Gentiles were on the throne. And there was some conflict. You see, many times we read Romans incorrectly. You know, it's Romans that was written before the Reformation, not after the Reformation. If you want to read Romans correctly, you've got to forget about the Reformation and you've got to get back into historical theology. And so the Gentiles come back in and everyone's there. And now there's a little bit of a dispute. The Gentiles think they've got it made and the Jews think they've got it made. And Paul comes and says, listen, you're right, Jews. The Gentiles were children of wrath. But chapter 2 goes on to say that actually the Jews were also had their own problems. And in chapter 3, verse 9, if you'll turn with me and if you'll put it on the overhead, in chapter 3, verse 9 of Romans, Paul goes on to conclude the following. What then? Are we, the Jews, better than they? Not at all. For we have previously proven to you and charged to you that both Jews and Greeks, that they're all under sin. And then in verse 23 says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Now, take that and combine it with Old Testament teaching on sin. And if you can put on the overhead, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 says the following, that many of us, even though we're saved, fail to recognize and fail to reappropriate to ourselves. We think for some magical reason that once we are saved, we're free. Once we're saved, sin doesn't tempt us. We actually can't sin is what we think. It's a hyper-Wesleyanism, if you would have it. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Isaiah chapter 53, verse 6 says, we all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. You see, for Paul, this was fundamental. For Paul, this was the missing link. For Paul, he recognized that something wasn't quite right with his life. But according to the law, according to his Pharisaic tradition, he was perfect. din punct de vedere a legii, desăvârșit.
Dar nu a fost desăvârșit.
Perfect, but yet not perfect. And it's that missing link that comes into our lives many times. Now, take a look at Romans chapter 1, verse 29. Paul illustrates how this sinfulness can affect my life and does affect and does impact my life, and it impacts each and every one of our lives. Those singing in choir, those that are ministering in the Word and in the church, and those that are listening to the minister of to the minister and to the ministry of the Word. Chapter 1, verse 29 says, starting with 28, "And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind, to those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness." Now that's a pretty generic term, don't you think? Unrighteousness. You know how postmodernism, you know in what postmodernism calls unrighteousness? They've changed the term, and they've rephrased the term. It sounds a little better. Unrighteousness, when someone says that someone is unrighteous, what does postmodernism say? He says, don't judge others. Unrighteousness? Hey, brother, come on, calm down. You've been through some schooling, haven't you? How dare you say unrighteousness? How dare you say sinful? It's a matter of choice. It's a matter of, listen, not judging others. Sexual immorality? Oh, come on. You know what happened in France with the revolution? We need to be liberated. You need to be able to do whatever you want to do. Being filled with unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness, their whisperers, backbiters, haters of God. Haters of God? Do we actually call people haters of God? No. You know how postmodernism has rephrased haters of God? I don't want to go through all the rephrasing of all of these things because they've all been rephrased by the devil. But haters of God has been rephrased as human rights advocates. Nu urători de Dumnezeu, ci apărători a drepturile omului. Wow! Ce cauză nobilă! Let a mother kill her baby and call it human rights. Let's just take everyone who's sick and ill and inject them with enough morphine to kill them. And we'll have Kevorkians all over the place. Why? Because man is sovereign and not God. Do you see where this sin is going in society? Now this sin, dear friends, is not just to society. It's something that is resident in us. It's something that attaches to me and attaches to you. There's another one that I'd like to cover. Disobedient to parents. That's here. Backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. What does postmodernism call kids that are disobedient to parents? Well, they don't call the kids that. They call the kids liberated. But what, you know, they turn the tide and they say, listen, parents are power-hungry monsters who want to control the lives of their children. Anybody heard that? Sin. We are fallen beings. We are fallen persons. And the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? If you want to understand life, you have to understand these fundamental principles. You have to understand that you and I are fallen beings. But, you know, enough for the kids. It's our turn. Because thank God, he deals with me too, big time. He's already been dealing with me in these verses. Now, you know what he deals with me? Take a look at Romans chapter 2, verse 21. "You, therefore, who teach another, do you not teach yourself? You who preach that man should not steal, do you steal? You who preach that man should not lie, do you, Leonard?" Lie?
Yeah. I've lied. And I've preached against lying. Why? Because I'm a fallen person. And I've got to be on guard. There's not a day that goes by that I don't have to be on guard. And that's the missing link that most of us don't understand, dear friends. Even though we're saved, we've got to be on guard. Vegyats. Kasanu kades in ispita. That goes for the apostles, that goes for the preachers, especially it goes for us. And God comes in and verse 22 says, you who say do not commit adultery, do you commit adultery in your mind, in your heart, in your imagination, in your private life? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who make your boast in the law, do you not dishonor God through breaking the law? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. You see, when someone who's not known sins, it's one thing. But when someone who's a minister of the Word of God sins, the name of God is blasphemed. That's why we have to be on guard, and we have to recognize, if we want to understand life, that there's something, there's a principle in our lives that God, even though He has taken care of it, keeps trying to bite us again and again and again. He tried to bite me today, He tried to bite me yesterday, and He'll try to bite me till the day that I die. Oh, but praise God, there's victory in the name of Jesus Christ. You see, let me conclude this part and look at what Paul says, as it is written. There is none righteous, no, not one. There's none who understands. There's none who seeks after God. They've all turned aside. They've become unprofitable. There's no one who does good, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. You see, when Paul begins to recognize and realize the missing link in life, what does he say when he looks at his life? O nenorocitul de mine. Cine mă va izbăvi de trupul acesta de păcat? Paul goes on and says, O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? 7:24. Now, we must come to terms with the reality of human sinfulness. It's all of us. It's not just the Baptists. It's not just the Presbyterians. It's not just those in the Union or COG or AG. It's not just the youth. It's each and every one of us. The devil tries to bite each and every one of us. Sin comes and tries to halt each and every one of us. We must not make excuses for our sin. We must confess it. We must pray that the Holy Spirit will make it clear to us, for sin deceives. The heart deceives. And when is the last time that you prayed, Holy Spirit, put tongues on hold for a minute? And Holy Spirit, convict me of sin. Not the sin in the church, but the sin in the seminia life. Holy Spirit, open my eyes that I may see Jesus, that I may see His blood, that I may see the cross. And for when the Spirit of God comes, He will convict us as pertains to sin in our lives, in our personal lives. We need this prayer here tonight. Is the Holy Spirit welcome in this place tonight? Amen. Is He welcome here to convict me and you of your sin and the need for repentance? Because I know, as sure as Arizona is hot this weekend, that there's sin that needs to be cured and dealt with in each and every one of our lives. May the Holy Spirit purge us tonight. We must pray for the strength to face it, admit it, and be disgusted by it. Oh, nenorocitul de mine.
We need more of those prayers. We need more of those bold declarations. As Paul, we must ask, who will deliver me from this body of death? We can't trust in ourselves. We can't trust in our power. We can't trust in our strength. We must always be on the alert. That is another second fundamental principle of life if we want to live and know how to live life. Now, as soon as you begin to figure these things out, you can start living. There's a freedom to recognize you're God's created being, you're God's created person, but you're also a fallen person. The third fundamental principle that we need for living is that we must understand that we can be rescued beings. We can be rescued beings. Paul in chapter 5, verses 6 through 8 states as follows. If you'll turn with me, it says in verse 6, "For when we were still without strength in due time, Christ died for the ungodly." He says, and he notes and includes himself, while we were without strength, while we were still sinners. And he goes on to say in 6:23 in Romans, "For the wages of sin is death." Now you see, something happens. When we recognize that we're this sinful person, it's like we're in a sea and we're lost at sea. And the waves are coming and they're drowning us. And we're inhaling water and we're inhaling air and we're sinking to the bottom. And we can't do anything about it. But if you want to understand fundamental life principles, you have to understand that in the moment when you're the most desperate, in the moment when you're the sickest, in the moment when you are utterly helpless and you can do absolutely nothing, it's that moment that God sends his rescue swimmer to jump into the water and to save you and me. You see, now, a while ago, pop culture released a film that had to do with the Coast Guard. And you know what the motto of the Coast Guard is? Why do people become rescue swimmers? That others may live. Do you know why God sent his rescue swimmer into this world that was lost and utterly helpless? That others may live. This is where it begins to all make sense. God valued his creation so much. God loved his creation so much that he sent Jesus Christ into this world to rescue you and I. And that means that if you're here tonight and you need forgiveness, if you're here tonight and you need healing emotionally, physically, if you need liberation from bondage, God's rescue swimmer, God's son, Jesus Christ, has come into this world and he offers salvation to all. That is a fundamental life principle. And you cannot understand life without it. And you cannot understand life if you don't get there. Now, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20 and 21, even though Christ has done everything for us, the Bible tells us that yet we must be reconciled to God. Even though we're trapped, asleep, dead in sins, he sent Jesus Christ to redeem us. And then you know why Paul has the courage to say that I am not ashamed of the gospel? Because it's this gospel, it's this fundamental principle of life that is the power of God into salvation. First to the Jew, and then to the Greek. Now, let me go on to point four, and I'll be approaching conclusion. The fourth fundamental principle of life for each and every one of us is that once saved, we must understand that we are transformed persons. Once saved, we must understand that we are transformed persons. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, Paul clearly notes that a saved person must walk differently in newness of life. 6:22 says, "We shall become slaves of God to have fruit to holiness." And it's because of that that Romans chapter 1, verse 1, and Paul speaking says that he has the courage to name himself a bond servant of Jesus Christ. Now, that's another fundamental error in Romanian Pentecostalism. It's a fundamental error in the understanding of the newly baptized persons. Newly baptized people, although saved, still have a lot of work. Newly baptized persons, although saved, still have to grow, still have to yield, still have to submit. Romans chapter 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It is a fundamental principle in life that you must expose your ears constantly to the preaching of the word of God. You can't live without it. Now, our brother preached that the sermons need to be without words. And he was right in his context. But I know this man. He preaches well and long. Why? Because faith comes by hearing. And if you're here tonight and you are hearing, God is working in your life and he's building faith. He's building faith to live differently. He's building faith to know that you are a creature of God, that you were created by a holy God, that you're sinful, and that he's offered you salvation. But you can't stop there. You need to keep growing. You need to keep yielding. Take a look at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, that will be part of your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. This is part of the stock of being a Christian and understanding. Now, once you're born again, you're in a process of growth that takes an entire lifetime. Paul understood that. He understood that he wasn't perfect. He understood that God was working in his life and continued to work in his life. Is there anyone here who God is no longer working in their lives? Absolutely not. God is working in each and every one of our lives. Glory be to his name. We've got to continue yielding. Finally, to understand life's fundamental principles and the things that will give us peace and success in life, we've got to understand that we're not just created persons. We're not just sinful persons. We're not just persons that have the possibility of being saved, redeemed. We're not just transformed persons. But dear friends, and this is absolutely fundamental that you understand this last point, we're also eternal persons. Eternal persons. Romans chapter 2, verses 7 through 11. And if you'll notice what he introduces in chapter 1, verse 1, he concludes throughout and he explains in all the parts of scripture that I'm reading from you. Romans chapter 2, 7, 11 says, eternal life to those who by patient continuance in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, but who those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation, and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, but glory and honor and peace to everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for there is no partiality with God. 2 Corinthians 5, 10 to 11 says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. You see, God has placed in each and every one of us the reality of eternity. He's placed it in my life, and we try to fight it. Society tries to fight it. Michael Jackson tried to fight it, didn't he? Michael Jackson's no longer around. He didn't make it to 60. And he tried to freeze himself so that he could have immortality. Why? Because he knew that life on earth is not eternal. Do you know that life on earth is not eternal? In Portland, it's my understanding that 2 weeks ago, a young lad, 18 years old, dropped dead of a heart condition. He's now in a coma, and we're praying that God would give him the gift of life and healing and restoration. But dear 18-year-old, 16-year-old, 25-year-old, just because you don't have gray hair, just because you don't have a little belly, just because you stand up really straight and look really good, don't think that you're not immortal. There will come a time when each and every one of us will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, because you have to understand life as life being eternal. You see, because God created us and His hands fashioned us, we were given a tent. We were given a body, we were given a suit, and we have to walk in this body, and we have to walk in the suit for a short period of time, for about 60, 70, 80, or 100 years. That's it. After that period of time, eternity waits for us. And we can either choose to spend eternity with God in heaven, or we can allow ourselves to spend eternity in hell with the devil. Now, dear friends, when the stakes are that high, do you see why we need to be motivated? Do you see why we can't get tired? Do you see why we need to keep preaching? Because there are certain things that are inclusive in the gospel of God, and there are certain things that are exclusive in the gospel of God. Inclusive, we're all created according to God's image. That's inclusive language. Inclusive, we've all fallen into sin. That's inclusive language. Inclusive, we're all eternal. Exclusive, even though Christ died to save sinners, He only died to save those who come and repent. He only died to save those who say, "Lord Jesus, I'm helpless, I'm drowning, I don't have my life figured out, I need your help, I recognize I'm a sinner, and I need your glory, and I need your loving kindness and mercy to come upon me." Exclusive. It's only those who have gone through salvation that have the grace of being transformed beings and have victory over sin. Even though sin comes and tempts me, oh, praise God that He has delivered me and He gives me victory in Jesus' name. So I'm going to ask you tonight in conclusion, which side of eternity are you on? If you're here tonight, or if you're watching online, whether you're in America or whether you're in Romania, and you haven't given your life over to Jesus Christ, if you haven't told Jesus, "Lord, I'm a sinner, I need your help. I thought I had my life figured out. I thought I had the grades. I thought I had the family. I thought I had the name. I thought I had everything else. But tonight your Holy Spirit convicted me. Oh, that I need to give my life to you, that I need to be baptized, because the word of the Lord says, 'He who believes and is baptized shall be saved, and he who does not believe shall be damned.'" And you're here tonight and you don't want to be damned. You don't want to go to hell. Well, I've got good news for you. The rescue swimmer has come to Arizona this weekend, and he wants to save you. But there's one thing about this rescue swimmer. He needs to hear the cry for help. God has said, "He who believes and is baptized," it means that you don't have to do anything except say, "Lord, I need your help." And I've got it from the Word of God that once you say that, the power of God comes in your life, and He gives you strength and power to withstand temptation. He gives you strength and power, even if you fall, to get back up and lead a life that's pleasing to Him. So I'd like us all to close our eyes and to bow our heads. În numele Domnului Iisus Hristos, vă îndemn să închideți ochii și să plecați capul înaintea Domnului. And I'm going to ask everyone here, young and old, if there's anyone here tonight that has not received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and is not baptized, has not made a commitment to Jesus Christ, and tonight the Word of God spoke to you, and tonight the Lord is tugging on your heart, as I know He has been, and you'd like to give your life to Jesus Christ and ask Him to forgive you your sins. And not only that, but follow through and say, "Lord, I want to seek you. I'd like to be baptized. Yes, I've been born in a Christian home. Oh, but I haven't been who I need to be. Or, Lord, I'm of the age right now when I can be, when I know and I've heard your word," whether you're in the youth choir, whether you're down here. If there's anyone that wants to receive Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior and be saved and figure life out, would you please raise your right hand toward heaven? Yes, and keep it high. Yes. Are there others in the choir? Are there those who want to give your life to Jesus Christ and say, Lord, tonight I'm committing my life to you. I want to give everything to you. I'm going to ask those of you who've raised your hands to come over here on my right. We'd like to pray with you. Have courage. Those of you who've raised your hands, those in the youth choir, come down quickly. And the Lord and us will meet you here. The rescue swimmer is coming to help. And he's got the power of God in his hands. You see, there is power in the Word of God. There is power in the gospel of God. This is the gospel, and I am not ashamed of this gospel. I am sure this works because it worked with me. It worked with my life. Those of you who've raised your hands and those of you who haven't raised your hands, but you'd like to give your life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to come here and kneel right in front of the altar and give it to Jesus. You see, we've come here to Arizona and we've come to have a good convention. And we've come to meet each other. And we've come to know each other. But there's something more important. There's something that is eternally important. If you leave here tonight, whether you're 18 or 40, and you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ, you could die and go into eternity without Christ. And that's why Paul says that he's pleading on God's behalf. As those from the choir come, if there's anyone else in the audience that would like to give their lives to Jesus Christ, I ask you in Jesus' name to come forward. With all eyes closed and heads bowed, I'm going to ask another important question. Of those who have given your lives to Jesus Christ, everyone here on my right who's giving their lives to Jesus Christ for the first time tonight, here on the right. For those of you who have given your, pardon me, at my right, over there, yes. Over there. For those of you who have given your lives to Jesus Christ, and yet the transformation part of your life has been suffering. Sin has come into your life and it gotten the best of you. And tonight you'd like to come to Jesus and say, Lord, I recognize that my life is suffering. I recognize that my life needs to be closer to you. I recognize that my life needs to be more committed to you. I need more passion to serve you. I need more passion to love you. I need more passion to be like you. I'm going to ask you to step forward and come here on my left and commit your lives again and tell the Lord that again you want to serve Him. And dear friends, dear adults, dear children, those of you who have committed your lives to Jesus Christ, don't let this convention finish without you getting closer to the Lord. If you need an anointing from the Lord, if you need forgiveness, if you need the assurance of salvation, if you need to have Jesus Christ come into your life, come into your family. We're not here to spectate. For crying out loud, we're Pentecostals. You know? We're Pentecostals who believe in the move of the Spirit. We're Pentecostals who believe and who pray. Could we earnestly in spirit join in spirit? You know, we're in a church where the name of the Lord has been called, and he who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You shall be saved. Even though you're standing and singing, your song is not important now. It's important that you come on your knees and get before God if you need to. And if your life needs to be made right with God, if you need victory over sin, if you need to commit yourself to Jesus Christ, young and old, male and female, rich and poor, whoever you may be from Arizona or from Seattle, It's time for you to come and meet the Lord. It's time for you to come and have fellowship with the Lord. I implore you, Jesus Christ is calling you. Come forward. I'd like us all to stand, except those who are on your knees. We're going to pray together. We're going to sing a song. And while we're singing this song, if there are others who need to give their lives to Jesus Christ for the first time, the altar's open. The altar's open. If there are those of you who need to recommit your lives to Jesus Christ, you need victory over sin. You need victory over temptation. You want to say, Lord, I want to be on your side. I want to live a life that has no missing link. I want to live the gospel of God with my heart, mind, and soul. Come over here on my left. And those of us who are in the audience, shall we lift our hands toward heaven and pray for these people? În timpul acestei cântări, dacă mai sunt alții care au nevoie de mântuire, altarul este deschis pe partea a mea dreaptă. Altarul este deschis pentru cei care au doresc să-și dedice din nou viața Domnului, să fie predați în mâna Domnului, să aibă victorie în viața lor personală. Partea stângă este deschisă aici. Cu toții intrăm în cântare și rugăciune înaintea lui Dumnezeu, cerând mila și îndurarea Domnului. Invite pe frații lucrători să vină în față, să rugăm împreună cu aceștia. And those of you who are on your knees, start praying to God. Tell him, Lord Jesus, I need salvation. I need power. I need your strength. Oh, I need forgiveness. Împreună cu toții ne rugăm Domnului. Împreună cu toții cântăm înaintea lui Dumnezeu. Oh, let's go pray.